Today, I'd like to introduce Irving Luke. I've known him for quite a while. He is a Louisiana birder, a homegrown, and he really credits people like Tom Sylvester and Nancy Newfield for launching his interest in nature and ornithology and certainly his career path. Irving studied natural resource conservation management at McNeese State University and got his master's degree there, studying map turtles, looking at their range and distribution in some of the rivers like the Sabine, Calcasieu, and the Mermentau rivers. And I'd like to hear about that sometime. And then for 6 years, he worked with Lake Charles Parks as an educator doing nature education, and has also been a volunteer bird bander doing some bird banding at the Sam Houston Jones State Park and elsewhere. He's also done some work in the summer with the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries, and even did a kite survey or two, so also kite survey from the airplane helping us out. And then in earlier this year in 2021, he took the position as the first Whooping Crane Outreach Coordinator for Louisiana, working for the International Crane Foundation. And tonight he is going to talk about his work there and how he is building an appreciation for whooping cranes in Louisiana through his various outreach efforts. So Irving, we're really happy to have you here tonight. Thank you. And please go ahead and tell us about the cranes.
Thank you for introducing me, and thank you for inviting me to speak to you guys tonight. This is really great. I'll go ahead and share my screen and get started.
Fantastic.
Okay, can you see it?
Looks good.
Awesome. Okay, yeah, so I wanted to, with this talk especially, introduce you all to the International Crane Foundation and what we do, and, as well as why cranes are such a great focal group of birds, the story of Louisiana's whooping cranes and sandhill cranes, and how birders can help Louisiana's whooping cranes continue their comeback. So the International Crane Foundation works worldwide with all 15 crane species, and we conserve and work with communities to conserve the ecosystems, watersheds, and flyways on which they depend. So I'll kind of show you guys some of the different cranes that we work with real quick, since I know a lot of you are birders, so you'll find this interesting. So there's 15 crane species on every continent except for South America and Antarctica. They're all relatively large, wetland-dependent, grassland-dependent birds. Out of the 15 species, 11 are listed as threatened or endangered. And that's kind of just what you get with when you're talking about big birds that need a lot of space, and they tend to live in communities that where humans are competing for that space. So they have some issues with habitat loss and that sort of thing. And we'll talk more about that in relation to the whooping crane in particular. But first off, before we talk about Louisiana's cranes, I wanted to kind of talk a little bit about why cranes are so awesome and what humans kind of see in cranes. So this is a picture actually from the country of Bhutan, where there's a crane festival welcoming the black-neck cranes back to the country after they spend the summer north of the Himalayas, essentially. So one of the big things that makes cranes something that humans can really relate to is that they dance. All crane species dance and have elaborate courtship displays. Also, many species, including this this family of sandhill cranes, raise young. They stay, you know, the pairs stay together for multiple years. So there's a lot of similarities between cranes and their families and humans and our own families. So in a way, humans around the world have seen cranes as reflections of ourselves for a long, long time. And that's why you see so many cultures around the world, from Native Americans to Europeans to Africans to Australians to Asians, that really love cranes and draw a lot of symbolism from them. They're also huge. The smallest species, the demoiselle crane, is about 3 feet tall. And the tallest is about 6 feet tall. But these are two of the charismatic species in Africa, the gray-crowned crane and blue crane. These are both species that are about 4 feet tall and are both national birds. The gray-crowned crane is the national bird of Uganda, and the blue crane is the national bird of South Africa. And they're both dealing with their own conflicts with human communities as well, particularly with farmers. Besides them being charismatic, I wanted to share a personal story. I actually took this picture in 2009, the first time I ever saw cranes in the wild. And I was a relatively new birder. I was only birding for a few years before this. I was a student at McNeese at the time. And had no idea that Louisiana even hosted cranes at all. And this was before the whooping crane reintroductions had started. And I was just blown away by their size, their behaviors, their calls, which the calls of sandhill cranes seem to carry for miles, and just their overall beauty. Their gray bodies, their red skin on the heads, in contrast with the grassland habitats where they were. But I'm not a unique case. Typically people, whether or not they're a birder, when they see a crane in the wild, it's something that just captivates you. So in North America, we have two crane species. I've already talked a little bit about them. Sandhill cranes, which are about 4 feet tall, largely all gray, with red on the head, and whooping cranes, which are 5 feet tall, pretty much all white with black wingtips and a red cap and a red black mustache. They're both long-legged birds with long bills that are adapted to wetlands and digging for tubers and catching crawfish and snakes and frogs and basically eating anything they can find in the wetlands. And both of these species would have been somewhat familiar to the indigenous tribes that were here in Louisiana and coastal Texas. They also would have been familiar to the Cajuns and Acadians that were here that settled this area, Creole and American settlers of the 1800s as well. In fact, they were so familiar that they were sometimes considered pests of crops like corn or sweet potatoes, that sort of thing. And there's even stories of people hunting them for meat, collecting eggs and raising chicks of theirs. All kinds of crazy stuff went on back then. But we largely lost them. And I'll get to more details in the story in a minute. But hopefully they'll become more familiar to us and our descendants in Louisiana as well. That's part of why I'm here and why the International Crane Foundation is working here, along with the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries. So historically, whooping cranes ranged across the green areas on this map, a large portion of the northern part of the U.S. as well as into Canada is where they raise their young, in the marshes and prairie pothole regions is what it's known as now. A lot of the ducks we have in Louisiana also reproduce in these areas. There was another population of breeding cranes that lived in coastal Louisiana and Texas as well. And they largely wintered here in central Mexico and a little bit along the Atlantic coast as well. Not a whole lot's known. By the time settlers came into these areas, a lot of the whooping cranes were forced out. So this is kind of, you know, looking at the evidence we have of where whooping cranes were seen and then drawing connections. However, by the 1930s, the population of whooping cranes was reduced down to a single flyway that breeds up in Wood Buffalo National Park in Canada and winters in Aransas National Wildlife Refuge in coastal Texas, kind of in the Rockport, Corpus Christi area. And yeah, by the 50s, it was limited to this one population. In Louisiana specifically, we had whooping cranes that spent the summer and winter in the coastal marshes, as well as whooping cranes that spent the winter in the coastal prairies. So that's kind of what this map shows. However, this population became highly endangered in the 1940s. There were only about 13 whooping cranes left in the White Lake area. And then by 1940, the population started really dwindling after a major hurricane. It flooded the whole area for months. And by 1950, they became completely extirpated in Louisiana. And they became extirpated due to primarily some habitat loss. This is a excavator building levees to grow rice in the marshes in southwest Louisiana. Also unregulated hunting. Species of many, many, many kinds were hunted back in the 1800s and early 1900s. It was the heyday of refrigerated rail cars where these birds could be shot and packed and sent to markets in New Orleans or in Chicago or on the East Coast or wherever. So you had cranes, rails, ducks, shorebirds, turtles as well that were all just kind of shipped to these meat markets, basically. And this was completely unregulated hunting. And then a third cause for their decline was the hat trade. Which also, as you guys probably are familiar with, affected egrets and herons. Their plumes were desirable for hats. Cranes also have really nice, really big white and black feathers that could be used in the hat trade as well. And so in 1950, the last whooping crane in Louisiana was captured by helicopter and brought to Aransas, where they had hoped that it would breed with a captive crane in Aransas, but unfortunately it died within about 6 months. So that was the last whooping crane taken out of the captivity or taken out of the wild in Louisiana. And with that, we completely lost our whooping cranes. I did want to circle back to sandhill cranes though, because they actually had a very, very similar population in Louisiana. There were sandhills that reproduced in the marshes of Louisiana, and there were additional sandhills that spent the winter in the prairies of Louisiana. And unfortunately, by the 1930s or so, sandhills were also completely extirpated from Louisiana. The last record of breeding was, I think, in the 20s or 30s, and actually that last colt that was captured is, I believe, possibly on display at the LSU Museum of Natural History, or at least it was brought there. And periodically, we would see sandhills in Louisiana, likely strays from a different flyway. However, as I mentioned before, we do have wild sandhills in Louisiana that, as their population expanded in other places over the last century, they did start wintering here again in the 1980s or so. And that's largely because sandhills are just a little bit more adaptable. There were always many, many, many more sandhill cranes than whooping cranes in the world. And so they weren't down to as few in numbers. So after nearly 60 years since Mac was captured from White Lake in Louisiana, the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries and multiple other agencies, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, the International Crane Foundation, decided to join forces and start reintroducing whooping cranes into Louisiana. And part of the reason it took this long until the 2000s or 2011 is when they started was because there was always a worry that that these Cajuns that are in Louisiana would shoot them and eat them, basically. Yeah, so they were released in the White Lake area, and some started being released at Rockefeller as well. But in order to release whooping cranes, you first must have whooping cranes to release. So there are and were breeding programs at multiple different zoos and facilities across the US and Canada. So Calgary Zoo, this picture is actually from the International Crane Foundation in the isolation rearing facility. Patuxent Wildlife Research Center in Maryland, the Audubon Species Survival Center in New Orleans, along with a few other zoos and conservation centers, were the primary sources for breeding whooping cranes and sending chicks to Louisiana. And this is at the isolation rearing facility where these chicks are reared by people in costume. They don't know a person's rearing them. And they never see a person at that facility so that they don't imprint on people. That was an issue in past reintroductions where they would be imprinted on something that wasn't a whooping crane, and then it would be a real struggle to get them to breed with other whooping cranes. So it's a little bit different than chickens or ducks or geese that you might have at home, where it's almost a good thing if they imprint on you, because then they follow you around. But with cranes, it's a little bit different. And then each year, aside from last year because of the pandemic, whooping cranes have been sent to Louisiana from all these other facilities. And the largest cohort, each group is called a cohort, was around two dozen. I think it was 23 birds were released for a couple of different years. This is actually one of those 23 crane cohorts that was brought in to Louisiana. They're flown in, brought by boat out to the pen, which I'll show in a minute, and are released into the marsh at White Lake or at Rockefeller. I think now and moving forward, it'll just be at White Lake. When they arrive in Louisiana, they're given a health check, they're banded. There's color bands that are put on them, which allows us to identify individual birds at a distance, even if their transmitter is not working. And each bird's given a transmitter, sometimes radio transmitters, sometimes a GPS transmitter. It just depends on the budget and how many birds need transmitters and that sort of thing. Once they're checked out, they're put into a top netted pen. This is called a soft release. So it gives the crane some time to get used to their surroundings at White Lake, get used to the marsh in Louisiana, get used to the climate. They're coming from smaller pens and various climates and locations, and to get used to finding their own food in the marsh. After a few weeks, the top netted portion of the pen is removed and they're able to walk out into the fenced in area, which still protects them from predators, but they're able to fly out when they so choose. In Wisconsin, it's a little bit different, where they actually don't do a soft release like this. They just do what's termed a direct autumn release, where the cranes are released directly in the vicinity of a pair or a group of whooping cranes that are already on the landscape. And that's mostly so that they can learn the migration route from those cranes. In Louisiana, the cranes don't migrate, so we just release groups of young cranes. Once they're released, they find habitats across Southwest Louisiana. Some have gone and set up habitat or set up territories in East Texas as well. But I love this picture because it shows the cranes finding a habitat that's not too far from people. You know, they're not necessarily a species that needs to be in a remote habitat. They use crawfish fields, rice fields, and marshes as well. As you might imagine, this can create some conflict because they are closer to people and closer to roadways and stuff. And we'll talk about, I'll talk about some of the conflicts and stuff later. But I do want to emphasize that the vast majority of farmers that they're in contact with actually view the cranes as something that's positive or at least neutral. There's very little negative interactions with farmers. And unlike a lot of the birds you're probably familiar with, whether it's herons or songbirds, whooping cranes take a really long time to reach maturity. You can almost think of something more like a bald eagle, where they take about 4 or 5 years before they start really breeding. So whooping cranes take about 2 years before they leave their parents in their second year, but they typically won't pair up with another bird until they're 3 or 4 years old. Once they pair up, they'll stay paired up for years, especially if things are working out. Divorces do happen sometimes, but it'll take 2 or 3 years before they're really in the stride of breeding, having nesting territories and nesting every year and that sort of thing. So now I'll talk a little bit about their nesting. So this is a typical whooping crane nest in Louisiana. They're not all in crawfish fields, but a lot of them are in crawfish fields, and that's where this nest is. And they're really, there's a couple of good reasons why the cranes like nesting in crawfish fields and why they have some success nesting in crawfish fields. One is that they're surrounded by water, and they also have visibility because the vegetation's low, because these are cultivated fields. And being surrounded by water allows them to detect a nest predator even at night. If a mammalian predator is trying to get to the nest, the cranes will be able to hear it. And the water is kind of a deterrent. These crawfish fields tend to have about 1 foot to 18 inches of water on them. So that's a deterrent to something like a coyote or a bobcat. They're also close to food resources as well. And crawfish fields, because they're managed, the water level tends to be relatively stable. That can be important because in Louisiana in spring, we tend to get rainstorms and floods. So some of the nests in the marshes can tend to flood out sometimes in bad rainstorms. It can happen in crawfish fields too, but the fields are a little bit more managed. And cranes can actually add vegetation to their nest to raise the level if they need to. It just depends on if they can keep up with the rising water in a flood scenario. But this is a nest that I actually got to see. Whenever I saw it, the egg was no longer there. It had hatched. But this particular nest was about 30 inches in diameter, and it was in water that was about 18 inches deep. So that gives you an idea of the size of the nest and the size of the birds, too. And the vegetation is just all vegetation that the birds have gathered from around the nest. So a lot of times, if you were lucky enough to see a whooping crane nest, you would see kind of a halo of open water around the nest, which is the vegetation that they were pulling to mound up the nest, basically. And these nests are fairly just kind of sitting there. They're not floating. They're kind of anchored to the ground. And this is the chick from that nest. That nest actually had an egg that Sarah Zamorski of Wildlife and Fisheries had put in there that was a couple of days from hatching. They had done that because the original eggs were infertile, but the parents have hatched chicks before and are good parents. So we put an egg in there to let them raise a chick in the wild. And whooping crane chicks can swim. This chick is swimming like a little duck. It's in water that's about 18 inches deep. Adults rarely swim unless they really, really need to, but they can. But they don't have webbed toes like a duck does or anything like that. There's the chick, if you couldn't see it. The chicks are fairly well camouflaged, that cinnamon color. And whooping crane chicks and the adults sometimes will roost on the nests. I love this picture. This is from a trail cam that Wildlife and Fisheries had set up. This is the same chick a couple of weeks later. They grow very quickly. But it's safe to roost on the nest. It's safer than a levee. The chicks are still protected from predators and that sort of thing. And this is another whooping crane chick from this year. They do nest in the marsh. This is a chick from one of those nests. Unfortunately, this chick did not survive until fledging. But nesting in the marshes, you know, they're more inaccessible to people. It's harder for the biologists to track them sometimes, except from the air. But they're also sometimes a little bit more susceptible to predation or to flood events, that sort of thing too. Rarely do whooping cranes raise two chicks in a year, but it has happened. This is a pair of chicks from a couple of years ago in Louisiana that run a crawfish field. And there's actually a pair of chicks this year that survived until fledging in Louisiana as well. And I also just love this picture because you can see the variety of birds using this habitat. You see roseate spoonbills, great egrets, little blue herons, cormorants, and I'm sure lots of other birds out there as well that it's just kind of hard to tell because it's kind of blurry. And at about 80 to 90 days of age, the chicks fledge and take their first flights. And that's part of the challenge of reintroducing whooping cranes to Louisiana or to anywhere is that they take so long to do things because they're such big birds. So it takes about a month of incubation and then about 3 months of growth before a chick is able to fly. So that's 4 months where the family of cranes is essentially kind of stuck in one area. So if they get unlucky or if they might have picked an area that's not perfect, they could have some issues. So we have had really low nest success in Louisiana, but it's been a similar issue in the Wisconsin reintroduction project as well. It's just difficult reintroducing these birds, and they take a while to figure out themselves and figure out the area where they're at. But they do find abundant food in Louisiana. This is a cottonmouth that this adult male whooping crane caught, killed, and ate. I guess that's probably the safest way to handle a cottonmouth without getting bitten. But they eat pretty much anything that they can get. I already kind of mentioned that. They do eat crawfish, but they eat a lot of other things too. And whooping cranes do tend to flock a little bit in the non-breeding season. So after they're done and it's getting about this time of year, November, October, November, they will flock into larger groups. Never as large as sandhills. You'll see hundreds or thousands of sandhills in Louisiana and other places. But just this migratory season, there have been flocks of 45 seen in Nebraska, whooping cranes migrating down south towards Texas. And in one day, I think there were like 95 seen in Nebraska, which I think might have been a record since we've been recording whooping crane migration. But hopefully, as the population continues to grow, these flocks become more common, and that also makes it easier to see them as well. So I'm happy to announce that this population graph is actually out of date because Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries released three birds within the past week. I actually just found out about it about an hour ago, so I didn't get a chance to update this graph. But the main takeaway is that we've released about 150 birds in Louisiana, and we have about 73 on the landscape. The population has continued to grow. We're still reliant on birds being released onto the landscape, but the proportion of birds that are wild hatched in Louisiana is increasing. That's the blue bars that you see. And we have moved a few individuals from the Florida non-migratory population. That's a failed reintroduction that I'll mention in a little bit. So to give kind of an overview of whooping cranes across the world, really, this is a good map. It shows the migratory path between Wood Buffalo National Park and Aransas National Wildlife Refuge. That's the only natural population of whooping cranes, the original population, whatever you want to call it. The whooping cranes there are just starting to arrive at Aransas, by the way. And we have another migratory population in the Eastern Flyaway that breeds in Wisconsin. And winter is down in Indiana and Alabama, and very few now reach Florida. And that population number is about the same as Louisiana, about 75, I think. And then we have our non-migratory population in Louisiana that's kind of based at White Lake, but there are a lot of birds and kind of throughout the crawfish and rice growing regions of Louisiana, as well as there were two pairs this year in East Texas that nested as well. And there was a non-migratory flock reintroduced in Florida. There's only around under 10 individuals in that population left. It's considered kind of a failed reintroduction due to additional predation and development pressures. And there were also some droughts in the 90s whenever they were releasing birds there. But all in all, there's over 800 whooping cranes in the world, around 650 of those in the wild, and around 140 or so in captivity. And those numbers are always fluctuating. Cranes are hatching, cranes are dying, that sort of thing. So I tend to just kind of use round numbers when talking about them. And these numbers are from the early part of 2020. So they are gonna be a little bit out of date. There should be surveys in Aransas in February where we should get better numbers on the population there. So I did want to issue a challenge to you guys. I know a lot of y'all are in New Orleans, so you're a little bit farther from me than the group I was giving this presentation to in Lake Charles last week. But I did want to challenge y'all to go see some sandhill cranes. They're a lot easier than whooping cranes to find and to see. There's a lot more of them. And they're super charismatic as well. Like I mentioned before, I know some people have kind of been joining late. Sandhill cranes are 4 feet tall. They're gray. They sometimes blend in, but also kind of stand out from the grasses and marshes where they tend to be. And their calls carry for at least a mile, if not more. And you can see them in Southwest Louisiana. There's a flock in the Alexandria area. And y'all may actually be closer to the Mississippi Sandhill Crane National Wildlife Refuge in kind of the Biloxi Gulfport area of Mississippi around I-10. I'm not familiar with there. I have yet to visit that refuge, though it's on my list. But if you did want to come see the sandhill cranes, southeast of Lake Charles is where to go. North of Cameron Prairie National Wildlife Refuge is excellent for looking at sandhill cranes. I've seen them around Lacassine National Wildlife Refuge too, where they've also hosted whooping cranes in the past. I don't think there's any that are hanging out there presently, but you never know. But if you do happen to see a whooping crane, we do ask that you be a crane hero. Please don't share the location info with anyone aside from a county or parish level. And yes, I say county because there are some in other states. Keep a distance of about 200 yards from whooping cranes, especially if you're on foot. If you're in a car, a little bit closer is okay, but do try to keep your distance. We don't want the cranes to acclimate to people, and we don't want to cause more stress than we need to. Report all whooping crane harassment if you see someone harassing them or disturbing them or, heaven forbid, poaching them. The number's right there, 800-442-2511, and that's the game thief number for Louisiana. Respect private property. Most of the cranes in Louisiana are on private property. Those are the ones that are more accessible typically, aside from the ones at White Lake, which most of that property is really hard to get to anyway. So we want you to respect private property because the farmers and the property owners have been huge supporters of the project. They allow the cranes to be on their property and don't mind them and let Sarah and Eva and Philip and other biologists with Wildlife and Fisheries to go and check on the cranes and to trap them if necessary, to change out transmitters, that sort of thing. So we want to keep good relationships with property owners. And you can report whooping crane sightings to LDWF as well. LDWF has a great website that talks about the whooping cranes and stuff, and you can report them as well on that same website. Aside from that, another way to be a great crane hero is to promote birding and nature appreciation of all kinds among not just other birders, but also children or your family members, your friends, because people that love nature and that love birding are not going to harm whooping cranes or other cranes or other forms of nature as well. Also, if you're able, support the conservation causes that continue to conserve these cranes, either financially or through volunteer service, that sort of thing. So we have the International Crane Foundation, Louisiana Wildlife and Fisheries Foundation. Purchasing a federal duck stamp, even if you're not a hunter, can help fund national wildlife refuges. There's just a lot of ways to help the cranes and other birds that use the wetland habitats that our cranes depend on. Yeah, with that being said, thank you for listening to me, and let me know if you have any questions.